And we have a few people would like to just say hello to and introduce to the towns. First of the bylaw review committee is Dan Monga. Is Dan here? Yep, he is. Dan, if you wouldn't mind just coming up and taking a minute or so just to say who you are.
Hi, how are you?
Good, that's good to see you.
Good. I'm Dan Monger, 5 Captain Daniel Litchfield, Scituate. I guess I got asked to do this through Selectmen Danahy. We had a deal opposite of each other recently. I'm a real estate land use attorney. Did a deal, you know, he mentioned that there was a need on some committees in town. I also know more and more people involved with the town, like Mr. Vignani. And I think my guilt is getting the better of me. I feel like I have something to contribute, and I want to, you know, be a part of helping make the town a great place to live.
That's great. Thank you. Thank you for coming forward.
Just to mention that, and Dan's being modest, Dan has a great wealth of experience of land use, and zoning and planning and contractual issues that certainly would be a great service in this capacity, both with the board bylaw review and maybe some other boards in the future. So thank you, Dan.
Yeah. Thank you.
I speak highly of him, too. Known him for years. He's been active in sports programs and always kind of looking for something to do, and looks like a good fit.
Fran McMillan for the Waterways Commission opening. I know, there he is. Fran, how are you tonight?
My name is Fran McMillan, and I'm currently an associate member of the Waterways Committee. I've been running a mooring and launch business in Scituate Harbor for the past 22 years, and I had a significant role in the federal and state dredging with the Harbor Master's Office. For the past 13 years now, we've been providing launch service for the Recreation Department and the sailing program, and recently we put in a laser float system, mooring system for them in the outer harbor to take the new floats. That being said, I guess the reason I'd like to become a full member of the Waterways Committee is it's become a very positive force in the harbor. The guys are doing a phenomenal job on things like the Maritime Center and the development of the Marine Park. And I feel that I could really help and contribute with my knowledge and experience in the harbor to further along with what they're doing right now.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And you're currently an associate member?
Yes, I am.
Great. It's a good stepping stone.
Kevin Wello.
Keith.
Please.
Keith.
Excuse me, Keith. Misread it.
My name is Keith Wello. I live at 200 Country Way in Scituate, obviously. I'm an associate member on the Waters Way also. And I actually own a mooring company in Scituate Harbor also. This will be our fourth season coming up. We take care of moorings and docks up and down the North and South River. And being that as our experience and the experience I had before I bought this company with North River Marine Enterprises with Franny Litchfield, I feel that I have a lot to give to the town and a lot of ideas that will help not just the harbor, but the merchants along with the harbor. And lastly, I'd like to say, if I can do half of what Franny Litchfield did for the town and the people in the town, I think I'll be very successful in the town.
Big shoes to fill.
Big shoes.
That statement. Yeah.
And are you, you're an associate member as well, right?
I am
now? Right.
Member, yes.
Great.
Thank you. Thank you. Brad White.
Good evening. My name is Brad White. I grew up in Scituate. I currently reside in Marshfield Hills on 149 Old Main Street. And I have a sincere interest in becoming a voting member of the Waterways Commission for a number of reasons. One is my good, dear friend Steve Smith, who passed away, and why there's a vacancy, was encouraged by me back in 06 or 07 to join Waterways, and he was an outstanding contributing member in natural resource management. And I can't hold a candle to that because of his expertise. My experience level has been in the business development management. My degree is in management. I went to Ithaca College in New York. I'm a Bachelor of Science in Management, studied in London, England, and I was at Cornell University in the ROTC. And I'm a licensed U.S. Coast Guard captain, 100-ton with sail and towing endorsements. I have two businesses in the general area of Marshfield and Scituate for the charter business and the use of the waterways, and I've been navigating the waterways for about 38 years now. And I feel that my contribution could be in horsepower, in expertise, in rallying the troops and getting the job done. I don't think anything's broken. I think the select people and the Waterways Commission and the Harbor Master's Office and the mooring guys have all done a fabulous job to keep our harbor pristine and inviting to boaters from all over the world. And I think we can continue to carry that torch, and I'd like to do that. I have an interesting situation where I showed an interest back in 2007, and because there was not a vacancy at that time, I applied to Marshfield. There was not a vacancy at that time in Marshfield, and they called me last week and said, hey, we're ready. I said, well, I'm really talking with Scituate on Tuesday, so I did in fact present myself in Marshfield last week with no decision from their board or from myself without speaking with you folks. I think that my involvement in the New Inlet Boating Association, which is located in Humrock, Mass., where there are about 60 boat captains, and the Stillwagon Bank Charter Captains Association, where there are 60 captains here on the South Shore, as well as the Northeast Charter Boat Captains, where there's about 60. So there's a population of really almost better than 200 people that I know and can reach out to and get that help and horsepower as well. Most importantly, to help protect and keep our waterways for the average guy who comes to use them, because I think I'm a big believer in public access, and I think that it's very important that we have free ramps in town that are well maintained and ones that anybody can come use and not have to pay a fee. So I think that's a real attribute to our town, and we'd like to continue to see that. I also see that we have opportunities in continuing the seeding of the river. I was involved with the clam seeding of the river 2 years ago and last year. I'd like to work with Dave Daphne in bringing some salmon back. The salmon were very prevalent here in the 1980s, and there's a whole campaign to get that happening. And something that I spoke with Howie Kretzenberg about last summer is that the town of Duxbury harvests about 5 million oysters per year, and we're not doing anything like that in Scituate, and perhaps we might be able to if we had the right chemistry of people and wherewithal in the North River. So I see a lot of future opportunity past our beautiful Maritime Center, which is soon to open, I understand, and I'd like to help to contribute. So,
thank you.
Thank you.
Thank
now,
you.
What has been your involvement up to this date? Have you been an associate member? Or
I have not been, no. I have
so
not
you
been.
Go to the meetings and...
I've been to a few meetings. I was involved with some of the events that happened over the last couple of years just in the building of the waterways. I have not been involved with the Maritime Center. Would welcome that opportunity as well. I just kind of threw my hat in the ring about 2 or 3 years ago and said, how can I join up and assist and be involved? So,
great.
Nothing to date.
That's great.
Okay.
I think... Three great candidates.
Brad, thank you.
Okay.
What we'll be doing is later on in the meeting, near the end of the meeting, as a matter of fact, we'll make these appointments, and you're more than welcome to stay around until that time, but there's no, on the other hand, there's no need for the applicants to stay around either, so it's entirely up to yourself. It'll probably be an hour and a half, maybe two. At 7:10, we have a public hearing on the change of managers for the River Club. If you'd come up, please.
Good evening. I'm Fred Zamanja.
Fred Zamanja.
Peter Boris. MWB, the owner of, and this is Peter Boris, who would be the putative manager that we're looking to replace Ellen McKenzie.
Yep. Fred, if you'd just give us a little history of what's happening.
Well, we're changing... we're going to be changing over the company. Peter and his brother Harry are going to be taking it over at the end of the year. And it's sort of a interim, in the interim time, Peter's going to be the manager and the liquor license until we transfer that later.
Do you mean it's being sold?
Sold?
It That's will be sold, yeah.
Okay.
Right, but right now it's still in the discussion. I'm
right.
Still working out details and things.
Right.
But Peter is getting his feet wet. His brother Harry, the two of them will be equity partners in the new entity that will ultimately take over. But right now, because Ellen McKenzie, who's been our liquor manager, she's going to be on site, but not all the time like she was in the past. And so we felt we wanted to have somebody that's going to be able to be there consistently.
And she will be our in-house caterer. Yeah.
She will be.
Yes,
yeah, she's
will.
Still going to be around and doing catering and things, but she won't be there on a day-to-day basis.
And just, Peter, what's your experience in the industry and in this business?
I've been in the restaurant business pretty much my whole life. I've had a liquor license in my name back in the 80s, and you know, have
in Scituate or
no,
in
no,
in
no.
Boston.
In Boston. In Boston.
Yes.
And he has a restaurant currently in Hull.
And I have a restaurant in Hull right now.
Any violations?
No violations. Never any violations.
Do you, this is the pizza box?
Yes.
This is it. Do you sell alcohol though there? Is that
no,
what
no.
is okay?
Oh.
But I've been there for 11 years.
Okay. What about the place where you worked that had a liquor license? You said was that the place in Boston?
It was a place in Boston, yes.
Okay. No violations on that
no
license.
No violations, no. Never had violations.
Sean?
What's gonna change? What's going on now? Is it open on weekends? Is it open for functions or both?
It's open for. It's always been open for functions, and we can continue to do so. But what Peter and Harry are going to be doing is ultimately reopening the pub and have that open on a day-to-day basis, and emphasize more and utilize the space, the function space more, I think, than what has been in the past, because it's been sort of moribund, really. I mean, the number of weddings has been.
We'll continue to use it as it's been used as a family traditional function facility, and you know, we'll have some events. It'll be an event venue, different events. You know, we'll book some nice entertainment and you know, comedy and.
So will it be regular hours on the weekends?
It'll be regular hours. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Without getting into too much detail, is it? This transaction, real estate involved, not real estate involved?
No real estate.
No.
No.
Further discussion from the board? Hearing none, a motion?
I'll move the Board of Selectmen vote to grant a change of manager for MWB LLC DBA The River Club at 78 Border Street. The new manager will be Peter Boris.
Second.
Further discussion from the board? Hearing none. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you. Good luck.
Good luck.
Thank you.
Unanimous. The next item is a pledge of a license, Tedeschi Store, number 359. I think I saw the gentleman here. Yep.
How are you?
How are you?
Good, how are you?
We saw you a couple of weeks ago, I guess, right?
Yeah.
Have you taken the premises over now? Or?
I have. I've been there for 3 weeks. Just started my fourth week.
Okay,
now.
Good, good.
Yeah.
How's it going, all right?
Yeah, busy.
Good, good. Yeah. That's a good thing.
So you got the shirt on.
Yes. Yeah.
And you're here tonight to ask that a license, your beer and wine license be pledged
right,
as security, okay? Anything you'd like to add? I didn't mean to.
No, just standard, I think, for the collateral from the bank.
Questions
motion?
From the board? Yep. Motion or question?
Just one quick. You want to make the motion first?
No, I'll wait.
Okay. I don't. Is this the normal practice? I haven't. This is the first one we've done here for a year and a half.
I've seen it.
I'd say it's normal.
So this is essentially for you looking at home. He's just putting local license up. Like, the bank is collateral for a loan to buy the inventory and the rest of this stuff in the store.
Right.
Yeah. If they don't, then obviously they have a right to execute on it. And
right.
So it enforces the ability for them to sell to make sure they adhere to it. And if not, then they can collect on it.
They just want to make sure I'm making their payment.
Yep.
That's
right.
Right.
Move that the Board of Selectmen vote to grant the request to pledge the retail wine and malt beverage license held by JBNJ Foods, Inc., doing business as Tedeschi's, number 39359, located at 377 Gannett Road, Scituate, Mass., to Weymouth Bank, 744 Broad Street, East Weymouth, Massachusetts.
Second.
Further discussion from the board, from the floor? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Janice. Thank you. Good luck.
Thanks, Lon.
See you down there.
Agenda item number 6 is the execute a contract for the Gannett Road pedestrian dash bicycle trail. Al, Kevin.
Thank you. Al Banger from the Department of Public Works. And
yep.
We're here. We've about this, we were here about a year ago. In 2008 at the town meeting funded a $550,000 CPA project to design and construct a sidewalk or bicycle path along Gannett Road from North Scituate to Hadley Road. An engineering firm was selected last summer. They conducted three well-attended public meetings in September, October, and late October. They conducted two public conservation commission hearings, and they conducted a site visit with each one of the abutters to the route along Gannett Road. The Department of Public Works solicited construction bids and received 9 proposals recently. The proposals averaged $375,000 to construct the sidewalk bike path along Gannett Road and a sidewalk along Henry Turner Bailey Road, a Chapter 90 project. The three low bidders were Frederickson Jones at $316,870,000, D'Alessandro of Woburn for $319,954,000, and Green Acres at $323,600. The engineering firm that we employed, Horsley Witten, was the consultant for this project and reviewed all the bidders' qualifications, and they recommend Frederickson Jones as the qualified low bidder for this project. We have had experience with this contractor, and we're very satisfied with their work, and therefore we request that the Board of Selectmen award this contract to Frederickson Jones. The funding for the project. Funding for the Gannett Road section of this project, which is $241,970, is provided by the CPA appropriation. The total cost of the project, once you add the construction, the engineering, and the contingency, is expected to come in around $325,000. That means that when this project is completed and wrapped up, we will be able to return to the town's CPA account a refund of about $225,000. Just a nice chunk of change. The Henry Turner Bailey Road section, which is $75,000, comes from Chapter 90 funds allocated to building this failed road. The economies that we can achieve by building the Henry Turner Bailey Road sidewalk at the same time that we're using the same firm to do the Gannett Road sidewalk, and at the same time that we're refinishing and resurfacing Henry Turner Bailey Road, is significant. We're going to be able to construct this section for about $55 per foot, a very low price for a sidewalk. This section will provide 37 homes along Henry Turner Bailey and Gannett Pasture and Whortleberry with a safe passage along what is now a well-traveled, busy route that has a history of safety issues. And this is one of the sidewalk gaps, one of the top priority sidewalk gaps that we identified in the sidewalk study completed a little over a year ago. So we would suggest that that you award the contract to Frederickson Jones for $316,870.
Comments?
Just a comment that Al touched on it, but was it the engineer from Horsley and Witten that you were quite impressed with the way he, you know, because we had some reservations a couple of years ago about when this first got proposed down Gannett Road, and Al, you know, made me feel a lot better the other day by telling me that the engineer that they had met with almost every single individual homeowner along the way on Gannett Road to explain to them what they would see when it was done. And Al said a lot of people who had some serious concerns really are on board, and that's a win-win situation.
To the extent that they could, he met with the interested abutters at the end of the driveway in front along the front of their line to talk about what would be the impact here, there, and please protect these bushes. This is something that was really important to me, and he tried to accommodate all of those where technically possible within the plan, and has reviewed the plan to accommodate as many of those needs as he can.
Can I just have one other question? The sidewalk going up to either Whortleberry or
Gannett Pasture.
Yes, thanks. What side of? I mean, it's.
It will leave North Scituate on the south side, basically from extending tennis from the existing course. Sidewalk that was built with an MBTA project. Will go down to Whortleberry, where there'll be a proper crosswalk and overhead lighting, and then it'll continue up that side to Gannett Pasture. That was the least intrusive on the wetlands, and also from all aspects, the safest route.
John,
I just wanted to say, you know, obviously I'm not going to regurgitate and what Sean's already said, but I will say, at least with the sidewalk, I think it's imperative that we have it. We've had 2 deaths on that stretch. I know from the sidewalk report that we had back almost 3 years ago that you and as well as the other members had presented. This was, I think, if I'm not mistaken, the area that was of highest priority, and clearly that the neighborhoods will be able to use that to be able to get to North Scituate without having to be in the thoroughfare, so to speak. And I think I totally support it. You know, it's a health and safety issue, and it certainly will hopefully eradicate any future injuries that, you know, obviously this road, this stretch has clearly demonstrated is not just a possibility, but it's an ultimate dangerous location. So I'm fully supportive of it.
Tony?
Al, just a couple quick things. This one-page synopsis is perfect. It gets us right up to speed with all the questions we would have asked are literally answered right here. We have gotten a few emails with people kind of asking questions about it. This isn't being passed right now. We're just giving the contract right now. This got passed a town meeting, and all the discussions about whether or not it should have occurred, they've already gone by the wayside, and it's been passed a town meeting, and it's happening. So that's not what we're discussing right now. We're actually just giving out the contract. And I'm just ecstatic to see that we're getting $225,000 back from the project, you know, as opposed to the $550,000 that were allocated to it. So I think that's great, and
Not to mention what he left on the table.
Right.
316 to 319.
Any comments from the floor? Seeing none, I'll one, sir. If you would identify yourself just for the
record. My name is Mark McCormick. I live on Gannett Road, where the bicycle pedestrian thing is going. Can you give me a phone number for this company where I can contact them? Because I've got shrubbery and things like that are going to be affected, perhaps as much as anybody else on that road. So I would like to start talking to these folks sooner rather than later.
If I could suggest that you call Al, maybe even meet right now. Al will give you either his number or a person to call. But your best bet is to go right, speak to Al right now, and that'll go a long way, I think, hopefully, in solving that potential problem. Motion?
Move that the Board of Selectmen vote to award the contract for the Gannett Road Pedestrian Bicycle Trail, contract number 09-HW-03, to Leroy Jones Corp., doing business as Frederickson Jones Contracting of Walpole, Massachusetts, for a total bid price of $316,870, with payment to be made at the unit prices and or lump sum prices pending receipt of a certificate of insurance, 100% performance, and 100% labor and materials bond.
Second.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? It's unanimous. Thank you. Thank you, Kevin. Al?
Yep.
Thank you. I think that, as Sean pointed out, I think that really shows the importance, and maybe something the town's been somewhat lack of possibly over the years, in contacting those most affected by these projects, getting their input, seeing how they can be mitigated when at all possible. So this is a good example of that working pretty well, I think, hopefully. Item number 7, public hearing. All kinds of alcoholic beverages license for the Inner Scituate Harbor, 7 Beaver Dam Road.
Mr. Chair, I'm just going to recuse myself on this matter. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Noted.
Mr. Chairman, if someone could read the public hearing notice that was published in the newspaper.
Tony, could you do that?
Sure. This one, Kim?
Yeah.
The Board of Selectmen will hold a public hearing on Tuesday, September 22nd, 2009, in the Selectmen's Chamber, Scituate Town Hall, 600 Chief Justice Cushing Highway, Scituate, Mass., at 7:30, to consider the application for a common vicular's all kinds of alcoholic beverages license by the Inn at Scituate Harbor, Inc., DBA Inn at Scituate Harbor, for the premises located at 7 Beaver Dam Road, Scituate, Massachusetts. The premises consists of a 29-room inn with existing space approximately 2,500 square feet included in the building that was previously used as a restaurant bar. The building has 6 entrances / exits, 2 located on the west side of the north wing, 2 facing south on the east wing, and 2 facing north on the east wing. Signed, Board of Selectmen, Joseph Norton, John Danahy, Sean Harris, Richard Murray, and Anthony Vignani.
Thank you, Tony. If you would introduce yourself and tell us your plans and again.
My name is David Ferguson, and I'm with the Inn at Scituate Harbor. We're applying for a all-alcohol license. As we spoke of at our last meeting when we came in, the building came with the 2,500 square feet of a food and beverage space that had sort of gone defunct, and our plans are sort of to resurrect that in some form or fashion in the next few months to bring a better environment and a more successful environment to the Inn, and predominantly for the Inn guests and, of course, some of the public. So that's what we're applying for.
And what are your plans? Is it going to be a restaurant?
Right now, we have a few ideas, but we're actually probably honing in on the pub concept, not doing a restaurant. We're not really. I don't think we're going to position ourselves with the Inn to compete sort of with the restaurant business in Scituate, but we do feel that the pub environment will offer our guests and the public an additional alternative to what is in Scituate. So we're looking at a nice, cozy pub. It'll be have probably limited food service, you know, very, 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 you know, sort of related to snack foods, have a decor of a pub, and have the environment that goes with it.
Have you ever had a liquor license before?
No.
And who will the manager be?
I'm sorry?
Who will the manager be?
The manager is Linda Ferguson.
Okay. And has she ever had a liquor license before?
No, she has not.
Sean?
What about your partners? Do they have experience in this?
Yes, they do.
They have experience in the food and alcohol?
That's correct. Both myself and Mr. Lever have been in the hotel business for a combined probably 60 years. And we have been in full-service hotels for the entirety of that career. And so we are well aware of and well versed in all of that aspect of the food and beverage service industry and all the components of that.
And the manager knows about tip certification, all that
yes,
sort of
absolutely.
Stuff?
Yes, absolutely. Tip certification is absolutely important, and it will be required pretty much for all of our employees. Because it's an Inn, everybody will have an interaction with it. So all of our employees will certainly be tip certified.
Tony?
I think Sean and I are, you know, we've had all of the alcoholic issues coming up before us now, and we just want to make sure that everyone's on the same page about
absolutely.
About serving minors and the penalties that will be enforced if...
Can I just ask a question? So, can you serve alcohol up to a room?
Can we?
Would you be able to if you
yes,
were...
Yes, I would presume it would be part of the license. It would be part of room service. Right now, we have an age limit for guests registering in the Inn that you know allow us to sort of monitor IDs at check-in.
Really?
Okay. So it would be handled much the same way you would at a bar.
That's even more difficult. It's tough enough at a bar if it's busy, but then having someone from the staff deliver it to a room that who knows who's behind the door and how old they are. So.
The same requirements
right.
with regards to serving alcohol. We wouldn't leave alcohol in the room unattended type of idea. It wouldn't be like an honor bar or a mini bar situation. So if a guest did indeed request some liquor or alcohol, they would be ID'd according right. to our liquor license.
Just to say, where will the pub be? Same location as it was in the past, downstairs?
Yes. Downstairs, yes, that's correct.
How about the patio? Any intention of using the patio?
Yes. Yeah, we've that's been a part of our conversation as far as making that whole area part of the Inn, part of the working part of the pub. So yeah, we were looking at you know beautifying that and making that part of the pub itself.
Is that? And
that is not a part of this. As I understand it, that'll be a secondary request.
I was going to say, yeah, okay, that would be, right. yep, that's my point. Sean?
I just was going to follow up with maybe a comment before you asked about the audience that I've heard nothing but great things about
a lot of
it.
A lot of fun.
It's
just great 2 months.
I bet it's a lot of fun. It's and a ton of work, too. And hopefully this will continue. I see some of the neighbors out there, and I hope they endorse it. You know, it's
absolutely.
Maybe just, I was hoping you'd have a full menu, but I understand that's a whole nother business.
Yeah.
But you have to take small steps, I suppose. But
keep up the good work.
Tony, comment?
Just to reiterate what Sean said, congratulations on opening it on time. That was a lot of work in that first...
That was pretty exciting, yeah.
2 weeks. And personally, I've firsthand seen the customer service. You accommodated a party of my families, and I appreciate that. Lynn and David both helped out tremendously. So I can speak firsthand that it's everyone that stayed there thought it was a wonderful place, and then just the service from the staff was wonderful as well. So
thank you very much.
Thank you. Can I make a motion? Or?
Well, just let me go to the floor. Any comments from the floor? Yes, we do.
Henry Lynch, 15 Beaver Dam. I'm right next door.
Yep, Henry.
And I'm glad, Mr. Chairman, for you to the two members of the board that asked the questions about the certification of people in the serving alcohol. That's very important to us in light of what's happened both in Humrock and in, on Front Street just recently. We're so happy to see you in there. They've done a magnificent job. They put a lot of money. This license, that can help them be successful. And we'd love to see that happen. It's a lot better than what we were going to go through before with some of the members of the selectmen in this room. They stepped up to help us oppose what was going to be the condos or underground parking. These people have done a remarkable job. It's been landscaping. They brought back the people over there before. If we felt bad that when that place closed, there were people out of jobs, they brought them back. The building is beautiful, and we'd like to say we're in favor of it.
Thank you. That's very important.
Makes
that job a lot easier. We appreciate, we really appreciate those comments. Yes.
Jeff Jackson, 15 Beaver Dam. Yep. I concur with my husband, Henry. And I would just like to know what the vision of the pub is. Is it going to be open late, midnight, 12:30, 9 o'clock? Is it going to be entertainment? What are your provisions for libation that might be taken outside into the parking lot right next to our property?
Because we are an inn and we have, hotel guests, The hours of operation are going to be somewhat restricted. It really is going to be a place where there won't be any entertainment. We're not applying for that type of a license. Our hours of operation would be somewhere akin to, we have a quiet hour after 10 o'clock. So that'll probably be somewhat of a target that says after 10, either the pub will shut down or there'll be some provisions made so that there's limited noise or limited amounts of people in the pub at that time. I'm pretty sure the liquor license won't allow us to have people carry stuff out to the parking lots. We certainly will monitor that internally and be very vigilant about that, because we don't want that out there as well, because we have spent a lot of sweat hours out there trying to make that a nice place to see and be a part of, and we certainly don't want that disrupted by patrons of the pub.
Could I make a suggestion, and this may be for you to decide tonight, or come back, well, probably decide tonight. Would it be possible for the board to we have to give a time for this license as we make the motion tonight. In hearing what you just said about not wanting to open until 2 in the morning, you're not interested in that. I mean, 12 to 10, would that be hours you could live with? I think if I'm just tossing this out for any input. If you wanted to come back and say 12 to 12 or 12 to 11, I'm sure we'd entertain that.
We would probably go for 12 to 12. The flexibility, it really kind of depends on the business that develops out of that. We certainly don't want to be disruptive, but we don't want to necessarily be restrictive either.
Yeah, I agree.
As far as the patrons of the inn, because it really is, it's going to be a part of that, and it's really up to, it's really... going to be part of the inn, and we want our guests to be able to relax and enjoy the pub environment to the best of their ability, and certainly not cause disruption. So I would be hard pressed to say 10,
all
12
right,
to 10, 12 to 12, 12 to 1, but ultimately.
How about 12 to 12? 12 to 12? How's that?
How do the abutters feel about that? One fine, one shrug.
One.
Yeah, not one.
Kim, Joe? Kim,
I like
what?
The 12 to 10.
Hopefully you won't see any activity outside. They go from the pub to the room.
Correct.
It's not like it's open patio type scenario yet.
And that, I'm sorry to interrupt, Tony, but if next summer you decided to go out on the patio, that might
maybe we'd close the patio.
Different or something.
Well, I don't know how that works as far as the license goes, but certainly our intent is to have, we have guests that stay, so certainly anything past, you know, 10 p.m. is, you know, it's a quiet hour in the inn. Mm-hmm. So any disruption, whether it be people attending the pub or not, is certainly not going to be tolerated. But I would hate to, like I said, I'd hate to have the restriction to our inn guests because of
why don't we say 12 to 12 alcohol to be served in the physical building? And if you next summer decide that the patio is a possibility, then we'll come back and we'll extend the liquor license to the patio. I think in the past, just my memory serving me, I don't think there was, I don't remember any problems coming from the restaurant or the bar area. Do you,
Kim might.
We're all very, very aware of that, and we spend a lot of time and we talk about it a lot, so we certainly don't want to, anger any of our neighbors. We want to, really not disrupt our guests.
I mean, you know, I have to tell you, there's a lot invested here, and the last thing any license holder wants to do is jeopardize that for a six-pack of Bud Light or something. You know, it's just...
Correct.
We appreciate it. Let's make it 12 to 12. We'll go from there.
Perfect.
All right. And motion, if there's nothing else to say?
Move.
Go ahead, Tony. It's all yours.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to grant a common vicular's all-kind alcoholic beverage license to the Inn at Scituate Harbor, Inc., DBA Inn at Scituate Harbor, for the premises located at 7 Beaver Dam Road, Scituate, Massachusetts. The premises consists of a 29-room inn with existing space, approximately 2,500 square feet, included in the building that was previously used as a restaurant bar. The building has six entrances, exits, two located on the west side of the north wing, two facing south on the east wing, and two facing north on the east wing. This license will be active from 12 to 12 for liquor service inside of the building.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Good luck.
All right. Thank you very much.
Good luck, Dave.
Thank you all. The next agenda item is an update on the swine flu from our Director of Public Health, Jennifer Lamb Sullivan.
Thanks for coming
Jennifer,
in, Jennifer.
Thank you.
I appreciate it. Jennifer, I'm just going to jump in for 1 second. Jennifer tried to explain to me, give me an update of what was going on, and I wouldn't have been able to do it any justice, so I had asked her to come in. Thank you.
Don't you turn off the fan? Is it too loud?
I don't know.
Is that too loud? You can't hear?
Maybe we can get... Jennifer, just with all the news about the possibility of a serious flu season, at Sean's request, we asked you to come in and just give us a brief update on what the town's done, is doing, I guess, to prepare for that possibility. All yours.
Well, the first thing I need to tell you is the seasonal flu clinics that we had scheduled for October 7th and 8th are canceled. The reason being that this whole flu issue, both seasonal and H1N1, has been fluid and changing, not daily, but almost daily. And what happened is the feds originally said you will get your seasonal vaccine early, push it out, get it done, so that you're done and over with the seasonal flu clinics before we start the H1N1 clinics. Unfortunately, because we are state supplied rather than private supplied, we are the last ones to get our vaccine. And what has happened now is the federal government has said they are going to reduce their seasonal flu vaccine distribution to concentrate on the H1N1 vaccine distribution. So while we have a third of our normal supply, we do not have enough to run our clinics right now, and we don't have any definite dates of when the rest of that supply will be available. It will definitely be coming. We will definitely reschedule. but at this time I can't tell you when.
Okay.
Also, because this is a fluid and ever-evolving situation, it has been the most frustrating public health topic I've dealt with in my career, because we are being asked to plan for a major vaccination for our citizens, and while we are receiving constant updates and training and conference calls and seminars, and they're expanding laws and dropping laws so that additional people can be trained to give vaccinations. I don't know when I'm getting vaccine, I don't know how much vaccine I'm getting, and I don't know how many people want it, because it is a voluntary vaccine. And those are rather key planning issues, and that is what is making it difficult. I'm constantly on my email looking for the latest updates. The CDC and the Mass Department of Public Health have excellent websites. If people are interested, they should be going on those for the same updates that I get. For example, today, National Institutes of Health from the studies that have been done, feel that 10-year-olds and older will only need one shot. Younger will need two shots. Now, the priority groups are pregnant women, being that this particular virus seems to affect the fetuses. And there is some concern, I know, on some people's part with a thimerosal stabilizer for the vaccine. However, no studies have shown it to have an adverse impact. Some people choose to have the thimerosal-free vaccine, and they should be looking to that to their primary care physicians and or gynecologists. I don't know if we, on this town level, will be getting any of that type of vaccine. Also, household contacts of children 6 months or younger need to get it. So if mommy's pregnant, daddy-to-be needs to get the shot. If grandma's helping out or doing daycare, grandma needs to get the shot. And children and young adults from 6 months older to 24 years of age, especially if they have some underlying health issues or chronic illnesses, and people aged 25 to 64 with underlying health issues, asthma, things of that nature, and certainly the health care and the emergency medical services people need it. However, while those are the priority cases, we have been told not to deny it to anyone who wants it, and that the supply will continue as long as there are demand. Please realize anything I'm telling you is subject to change, because things we were told 2 months ago have already changed. Parents need to, check with their physicians about their children. If their children are middle to high school age, they will be getting it either in school or maybe on a Saturday clinic. We haven't finalized those things yet because we don't have enough information. But the parents also should be checking with their jobs and businesses to see what the family leave policy and their sick time issues are and what that's going to be. And if they have daycare, if they should be have an alternative plan in case their daycare closes. What are you going to do? If your child's sick, of course, you're going to stay home with them. But if your child is well and doesn't have a daycare service, what will you do? Businesses, you should be reviewing your policies in terms of family leave and sick time, because there is a chance that this flu, if it becomes a widespread, can be up to 30% absenteeism. And you should be looking at continuity plans. What are your crucial functions? Who are the crucial people? Who can you cross-train in case some of those people are sick? The CDC has just come out with a small business preparedness guide that you can download. And it would be helpful that, you provide hand sanitizers. This is International Clean Hands Week. Washing your hands is one of the major prevention issues and works quite well. Florence Nightingale discovered it in the Crimean War, and it still works today. Also, you should be coughing into a tissue or your elbow. If you're coughing into your hand, and then you go grab a doorknob or you shake somebody's hand, we're in trouble. If there's a lot of sick people, then you want to avoid large crowds. And certainly, if you are sick, stay home from work, stay home from school, stay home from daycare. So what have we done in town? Eileen Scotty is our public health nurse. She and I have discussed things in numerous times. We've been to various trainings in the past few years. We belong to Region 4 of the public health preparedness region. We're getting weekly updates. I have another conference call tomorrow. Before I left for vacation, I had 4 conference calls in the space of 3 days. There's a big statewide summit for medical and health people in Worcester at the end of the month that I will be attending. We had our own little town summit here a couple of weeks ago where we had the town administrator, the school superintendent, the school doctor, our doctor advisor to the Board of Health, Dr. Seidel, Eileen Scotty, the fire and police chiefs, and the school nurse medical coordinator. And the school nurse and medical coordinator and I are getting to be very best friends because we are constantly sharing information, telling each other the latest of stuff that we are hearing. And the schools, the Department of Education and the Department of Public Health are cooperating on a state level to be trying to send a consistent message through the schools as well as public health so that we're all on the same page. And so everyone hears the same message, that the parents aren't hearing something different from the schools than they're hearing from us. There's going to be more training. There's going to be more changes. There's also some additional federal funds that will be funneled through the State Department of Public Health, some of which will come down to the locals to help with the vaccinations. But again, we don't know how much money. We don't know when it's coming. We don't know if there are any strings attached. But that is as much as I can tell you right now. As I tell you, it's a fluid situation. And when I have more pertinent information and we schedule actual clinics, I would like to come back so that everyone in the town can be equally informed.
Thank you. Thank you very much for that. That's exactly what we're looking for. I would suggest that as things become more concrete and become more definite, you go through Tricia. You know, anything that comes up in between meetings, she can notify us very quickly. And as major developments come forward, if they do come forward, would ask you to come in again and just bring us up to date. But if you would just keep Tricia definitely in the loop so she could keep us in the loop, it would be greatly appreciated.
Okay, thank you.
Comments before you?
One quick question. Thank you very much. Are we out of the woods at any time of the year, like a first frost or the first snow, you know, the first temperature drop down? Is there a time when, not totally out of the woods, but is there a season for this?
Not really. What happened is it really mimicking the 1918 flu. Same deal. Started in the spring, lessened a little over the summer, and then hit very hard in the fall. That's why, they came up with various isolation policies and stuff. And that's why, they jumped right on getting a vaccine, because we want to minimize the number of people who get it, and we also want to minimize the symptoms if they do get it. I think because social distancing was very important in the 1918 flu, because there were 2 parades for the end of the World War I. One case, because of the flu in Philly, all went to the parade. In St. Louis, they were sort of told to stay away. more people stayed away in St. Louis than Philly. Philly, the people around Philly got a lot sicker. More people died than around St. Louis. We are in such an age now where within hours you could go from one end of the world to the other. So equally quickly, the vaccine is needed to stop that kind of a fast spread of a virus. So I think we're playing it by ear. I don't think we know. I don't think they have a good handle on it. I think we'll learn a lot from this, and I think they're banking a lot on the vaccine. Dr. DiMaria, he's chief of epidemiology up at MDPH, says the vaccine is safer than an Advil. I know that some people are worried over the past swine flu many years ago, but they have a lot of confidence in this because, and that shows in the fact that they are able to reduce it from two shots to one shot in the older population. The seniors are not indicated as necessarily needing the H1N1 shot because they feel that it is felt they have an accumulation of some immunity over the years with the flu-type diseases. They are certainly eligible to get it, but they are not a priority case.
Tony?
I think you may have just answered my question. And, you know, in the quick 30-second answer, if there is one, those people that are on the fence between getting it and not getting it because they've never gotten it before, and you hear that you're just getting the flu injected into you, what's the common thought in the medical community about that, about getting it?
I know people that are recommending, the doctors are recommending getting it. I'm getting it. I mean.
And what about the fact that there's a regular flu one and then the swine flu one?
Well,
Do they have to go in unison or?
Well, we do not have enough seasonal flu vaccine supply to do the same population that is targeted for H1N1. And the seasonal flu vaccine is targeted at the chronically ill and senior citizens, when we seem to have enough supply usually to do that population.
When you say we, are you talking about Scituate?
Yes, Scituate. You know, if there are private enterprises that are offering seasonal flu shots, and people are certainly able to go out and get them, but those they're being charged for. You know, we do it free of charge. But you're going to have to wait. They are saying that you can get the regular flu shot in one arm and the swine flu in the other arm. I don't know what they expect you to do with your arms afterwards, but I don't know that we'd have both vaccines at the same time because of the way they're supplying it.
I guess my question was more, if you don't get the flu shot, if you get the swine flu shot, it'll be just as effective. It doesn't. They're two independent
strains.
And separate.
Yes. H1N1 is definitely, that vaccine is definitely targeted for H1N1. The seasonal flu is more targeted on the Hong Kong flu, A, B, C, whatever it is, the combination that they usually see year to year.
Thank you.
John?
Jennifer, thanks for this. One of the questions I had was, I know that, is there an ability for the town to regulate the vaccine? I know you said that we get the vaccine, and it sounds like there are strings attached, so to speak, in order for the town to get. In other words, you're suggesting it would be better to be able to use the vaccine for certain segments of, you know, whether it's children or the more susceptible. And my question is, can we as a town regulate that to say, okay, this is what we want to allocate that towards because they're higher priority, and so to speak, because they're more susceptible? That's my first question. The other question I had was, you had mentioned about how we don't have, certainly for the seasonal flu vaccine, because we don't have enough for it. My question to that is, whether it's the seasonal or the H1N1, can we go out and buy it privately? And if that's the case, do we know what the costs are? Because, I mean, I get back to, if we can, you know, if this turns into a huge epidemic, you know. I'd rather have it on hand for the citizens of Scituate than to be, you know, doing other things.
The seasonal flu vaccine can be bought. The trouble is it takes time to grow it. And, you know, usually people order it in January or February to be ready for the flu season. And those usually are, that and the commercial supplies are usually considered private supplies, and doctors who pay full price will get their vaccines shipped sooner than the state who cuts a deal and gets it. And we get, you know, secondhand delivery. The H1N1 is totally under the federal control. There is no private purchase. And they are supplying it free. And they have said, as long as there is a demand, they will keep up the supply. And that's as much as I can tell you right now. As far as setting priorities, I don't know. I will funnel that question through the ranks and
but
see
we
what
have
I
the,
get.
We have the ability then to at least augment, if you will, the seasonal flu if we decide to opt to buy it privately.
But I don't know that it would be available during the flu season because of the time it takes to grow.
Okay. Thank you. Comments from the floor? Jennifer, if you do what we suggested, maybe just keep Church up to date as the situation changes. And as items become more important, come back and tell us.
Yep.
Scott?
Just a quick question. If you were an ordinary citizen and you wanted to get the local perspective on this, where would you go? The website?
I'll work with Mr. Rose on creating a page.
Creating a website.
But as I said, the CDC website and the mass.gov /DPH website are basically where I'm getting a lot of my information.
If I could just add to that, Mr. Chairman, we did talk about that at length at the meeting that the folks put together from the school and talked, and in the immediacy of the information, there will be information immediately posted on the website, on the cable channel, as well as, we have the ability to get information out on a variety of levels. And I just want to follow up on one of John's points, because there was also extensive discussion at that meeting about to whom would the vaccine be available and what order. And there was a lot of discussion with the school personnel since the real, another identified at-risk group potential for the H1N1 is in the 12 to 16 age group. So we had a lot of discussion around how we would give that vaccine if we were targeting that population, whether it be during the week or on a Saturday, if it would be controlled, and talk with that along those lines with the public safety people in the room as well. So there's been some discussions about a lot of the issues. And as Jennifer said, it's changing very quickly and differently. And so we're just trying to keep on top of it and then respond so that when we do put information out to the public, it's giving them accurate information and timely information.
Sounds like we're on top of it as much as you can be with the changes, so we appreciate that, and just keep it up.
Thanks, Jennifer.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jennifer.
Next item. There's the vacancies on the Board of Assessors. Agenda item number 9.
Do we just read this?
Yeah. Tony, would you have it here? Would you read that letter from Tim O'Brien?
The letter from Tim or the?
The resignation letter.
Sure.
Thank you.
This is a letter to the Board of Selectmen from Tim O'Brien, dated September 16, 2009. Effective this date, I resign as an elected assessor. The reason for my resignation is that I will be moving to Newton. I've enjoyed my service on the board. It's been a pleasure to work with Steve, Patty, Fred, and Brian. As mentioned at the previous Selectmen's meeting, I've been willing to represent the town on a pro bono basis at the Francis Xavier Caprini case, asking that I be reimbursed for only actual out-of-pocket expenses such as filing fees. I've argued before the Mass Supreme Judicial Court and written numerous appeals court briefs. From the chairman of the Mass Appellate Tax Board, I hear the most significant exemption cases so I'm very well familiar with the law in this area. Representing the town would be a way for me to keep in touch with the community. Sincerely, Timothy F. O'Brien.
Thank you, and thank you to Mr. O'Brien for his invaluable service. He brought a wealth of experience from his tenure as on the Board of Assessors at other cities and towns, so it was invaluable over the years. So, motion? Do we need a motion to accept that, Kim, or we?
No.
No. All right, so just to announce the vacancy, that there is a vacancy on the Board of Assessors, and if you'd be kind enough, if you're interested, to send your letter of interest to Selectman's office, Kim Donovan, by October 23rd. And then the appointment will be made, hopefully, on November 2nd. So if you're interested, October 23rd, send your letter in by, and sometime around the 1st of November, we'll make an appointment. Again, thank you to Mr. O'Brien. Next item. Next item is the Knights of Columbus request for Tootsie Roll Drive. John, did you have it in front of you?
Sure, Mr. Chair. Proclamation, whereas the Board of Selectmen would like to recognize a very worthy fundraising event sponsored by the local Scituate Council of the Knights of Columbus, and whereas this campaign will be conducted from Friday, October 16th to Sunday, October 18th, 2009, via their well-known Tootsie Roll Drive, which will benefit the physically challenged and learning disabled in various communities throughout the Commonwealth. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the entire town of Scituate and its Board of Selectmen thank the Knights of Columbus for their continued dedication to charitable organizations and hereby proclaim October 16th, 17th, 18th, 2009 as Knights of Columbus Days for the physically challenged and learning disabled, and urge all citizens of Scituate to participate in this important effort. Signed, this 22nd day of September 2009, the Board of Selectmen.
We don't need a motion on that, except to once again thank the Knights of Columbus for not only this, but all the work they do in town. So thank you, and good luck with your drive. Next is number 11, we're back to appointments again. The first one is a reappointment to a constable position. Motion?
I move that the Board of Selectmen reappoint Thomas Riley as constable in the town of Scituate.
Second.
Motion been made and seconded. Discussion? None. All in favor? Aye.
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 It's unanimous. Bylaw Review Committee.
I'd move that the Board of Selectmen appoint Daniel Monger to the Bylaw Review Committee.
Second.
Motion been made and seconded. Further discussion? All in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Aye.
It's unanimous. Next is the waterways.
Move that the Board of Selectmen appoint Keith Wallow as a full member of the Waterways Commission.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor?
Yeah, we had three great candidates, yeah. So we're lucky in this situation. And I hope the other ones become involved in the associate capacity that they have in the past.
Could I just chime in with Tony there? To the others, well, one's an associate now. If he can continue, and if Brad would become an associate and maybe get involved in Marshall as well, then you can see which would do better. You know?
If there's no conflict, Sean, I mean, I would be very interested in that, but I need to make sure with both towns that if I happen to be asked to be a non-voting associate here, would that be a conflict with Marshfield? Would that be a conflict here? I don't think it is. Marshfield said, no, hey, we try to work together as a team anyway. It's the same waterway, it's the same river, it's just got a different buoy to mark the two different committees, really, to be honest with you. So I would entertain that, but I probably should come up with some formal, or somebody should say to me, hey, it's okay, and not have me guide that, because I just kind of march forward and say, let's do it.
Great.
The liaison for waterways is not here. I'm sure he'll be on top of that the minute he comes back.
I think it'd be an asset to both towns. So, but you'll do it. Let us do it. Let us.
We'll research it.
Okay, all right.
We'll get in touch with you.
Motion's been made and seconded.
John Murphy. Chair of Waterways. I just want to say we did have three great candidates, and they are all involved. Brad, hope we do get involved with us. We'd love to have this on here. Great resume. He's going to do a great job. We'll love to do. I'm looking forward to Keith working with us. Craig's involved as an associate. He'll become involved and more help.
right?
Thank you, John.
That's John.
Thank you, John.
Motion's been made and seconded. It's already been made. All in favor?
Aye.
Has it been
made?
Yes.
Yeah, it has been
yes.
made. Aye.
Opposed? Congratulations. Keith.
Thank you, Keith.
Report from the town administrator. Second bi-weekly report from the town administrator. Third, wow, time Third. Flies.
Thank you. First item is a Minot Lighthouse update. As you know, Rick and John and I, well, Rick and John was unable but was informed of the meeting. Doug Smith and David Ball attended a meeting with the Cohasset Board of Selectmen to discuss our potential mutual or separate interests in acquisition of Minot Light. And it was a very good meeting. There were representatives from the Historical Society, from Cohasset as well. The gist of that meeting was that each town would submit a letter of interest, but cite the other community's interest in also working together collaboratively to see if it makes sense. I want to underscore, I think what David Ball has represented before is that a letter of interest simply allows the General Services Administration to determine whether or not our community will be formally invited to send and to submit a formal request and fully outline proposal to actually acquire and compete for the lighthouse. That has not been determined. The joint collaboration with Cohasset and the Historical Societies and Historical Commission will do that due diligence, I think, to determine whether it makes sense. Obviously, the comments that the boards echoed before as far as maintenance, in perpetuity, access, liability, cost, are all very much in the mind of the Cohasset Selectmen as well. I received a copy of Cohasset's letter that they are sending to the GSA. I've drafted one for the board, which I believe Kim has given to you, and John and Rick, as our designated representatives on this little subgroup, have approved it as well. So with the chair's signature, we'll send that in tomorrow.
I think it's important to keep in mind that these are exactly what the town administrator said. They're letters of interest. Once we, whoever sends in the letter of interest receives a response indicating that they're in the running for further discussions, that's when you get into the real discussions, I guess. This is strictly just telling them that, hey, we have an interest, and let it go from there. So,
Trish, it's my understanding that if no one shows an interest in it, then it goes up for public auction.
That is true.
So that would
that is
be...
True. But Mr. Ball's been involved with the American Lighthouse Federation, and this isn't on a quick moving train either, I want to emphasize. We don't even expect to have responses, look at if we get an invitation to do a proposal. Part of that obviously is a field visit, a site visit to the house in which those who go intend to document the internal part of the building, which very little is known about other than from the Coast Guard folks who go in and maintain minimally once a year. So we don't even anticipate that will happen to spring perhaps, because now is obviously not a good time. So it's not something the board or the town's going to have to respond to in a quick fashion.
Thank you.
The second thing is something I think I alluded will probably be on every report that I do as far as the finances, both immediate and short term for the town and the changing state aid situation. What you have attached is sort of a form that I've used for the last 10 or 15 years that Mary put together really quickly that just helps me know right away where we are as to revenue and expenditures. It's really a snapshot of what we approved at town meeting, so it's really not up to date and accurate right now. I mostly did it to plug in Scituate's numbers, and it sort of helps give you a frame of reference for what's driving the deficit right now for FY10 that's necessitating our November 2nd special town meeting. The other piece, though, that I want to hand out to you right now, as indicated in my report, is something I think the board members have been talking about for a while, is how are we doing, how do we know how we're doing, and how soon can we know how we're doing relative to the previous fiscal year and changing revenues and expenditures. So I'm going to pass this out. You can give one each as a revenue expenditure. This is a follow-up from a meeting that Tony and I had to go over the financial forecast, I think about 3 or 4 weeks ago. We came up with a dozen or so financial indicators that we want to monitor on a month-to-month basis. Mostly our conversation was in the context of revenues. I've done one for expenditures as well, and chosen a few for folks at home and in the audience who don't know what they're seeing. I'm on the expenditure page first. The things that we'll be monitoring, which is there's a budget, how much was expended in July as compared with July of the previous year, and we'll track them as a percentage expenditure throughout the fiscal year. Will be electricity on the town side, gas, as in gas for heat, fuel, overtime in the police and fire department, FICA, which is a derivative of our employee payroll expenses, and snow and ice. And as we compare those over FY09, you can already see we have the revenues. Mary's plugged in the expenditures for July and August already. The one thing I want to emphasize to the board, which might not be readily apparent, and I realize you're seeing this for the first time, and it's really a draft, so it's open to your comments, as I indicated in the report, is all of those budgets and those things that I just mentioned for FY10 were cut. So the FY09 amount to the FY10 budgeted amount is already lower. So when you look, if it's below, 1/12th or whatever, or above, that also has to be in the context that the budget is actually considerably lower than it was at original appropriation for FY09. So that's the one I particularly want to point out. As you can see, the indicator there is for 2 months, and one or two of the line items is something that I'll be addressing with the department, so that they're aware. Because we've never sort of captured this information, which is why I think it was such a great idea that Tony and the board wanted that. And we've captured it, but it's never been reflected in this way. So actually, we can give real-time information to the department heads right after the month ends to let them know how they're trending. Going on to the receipt thing, again, very quickly, on a monthly basis, we're looking at our receipts as they trended from now to from over FY09. Those drivers are real estate, tax lien deferrals and foreclosures, permits and inspections, motor vehicle excise, all other local receipts, state aid, and then two of the larger revenue enterprise funds I picked out are Widow's Walk and Transfer Station, because those had some challenges as of June 30th of this past year. So I want to look to see how we're doing for revenues. The good news on the receipt side is that we're doing very well, with one notable exception, which you already know is the decline in state aid, which is why we're having the November 2nd special town meeting. It's off quite a bit from the 09 numbers. We are still waiting our actual receipt in terms of the check being cut to the town for our state local aid quarterly payment for the town, but we already know it's been reduced from 09. And just to give you another snapshot on the local aid, and then I'll be quiet, is about $7 million of our budget is local aid, state aid. And from FY09 to FY10, we received a 9% reduction right off the top. So that number is never going to be better. You're going to see a parentheses, which indicates a deficit there for the rest of the year. So that 9% is just under $700,000 that we suffered. All that being said, I think standing right now with the $342,000 that you see that we have as a projected deficit, I do continue to have strong concerns about additional cuts from the state before the end of this fiscal year, maybe even before this calendar year. And looking at those drivers that you saw in those two reports, we want to make sure we're taking steps now with 9 months left in the fiscal year to mitigate those. All department heads are due to report back their budgetary challenges if they anticipate any other than the ones we already know by September 24th. So I can look at those and do the draft warrant so the board will be able to review that and we can have a robust discussion on October 6th.
This is excellent.
Thank you. Yeah, this is great. I think as you continue to give us this, it'll become more and more beneficial to us, you know, as we...
Yeah, it's hard with only 2 months, but as you can see,
I see some discrepancies, and I'm sitting here going, why is that going that way? Really? But at least it gives us an idea of...
Rather than get into it now, you know, the individual numbers.
Yeah, it's a draft, because I know I'm waiting for Tony's input, because I value it. But I think this, I hope this starts to begin to capture the things that you had wanted for a while.
Thank you.
Thanks. It's great.
Great.
That's it.
Simple enough. Thank you.
How about the other two items or no?
Unless you have comments, they're just really informational.
Yeah, just an announcement about the special town meeting.
Yep.
Yeah, that's, when is that set for? November
2nd.
So November 2nd will be the special town meeting. Great.
Other business? Sean?
Just one thing, if you don't mind, Joe. The Recreation Commission is having their fall and winter sign-ups this Saturday,
okay.
8 to 10.
Okay.
I said you'd help with me. You want to call that to you?
Be there.
Should I start without you?
You can start.
No, I just wanted to make the announcement. It's always a lot of people.
Thank you.
That was it. Thank you.
John?
I was going to follow up with Tony had mentioned last time about Coors. Coors is having their fundraiser for this Friday, and that's a golf at Whittle's Walk, and I just wanted to say that people are, they should, if they can, participate. It's a great event. It raises money for disabilities. It's phenomenal, and I highly recommend it. The other thing I wanted to say is, and I've missed it for the past two meetings, is that... kudos to the Hamilton Company. You know, they won the award for one of the awards. There were about, I think, 6 to 8 people who received for historical preservation during the Heritage Days. But I think it really goes to stand that, you know, the Hamilton Company and trying to preserve the Welsh Company has no doubt put a lot of money into it. Last week I was before the Zoning Board, which approved the parking situation was raised. I mean, you just go down that street and you see what they've done to... what was the Flounder Inn? I mean, they've literally gutted the building. That's an expense that, you know, clearly to try to preserve would have been better served to have torn the building down and built it, but they've put a lot of money into trying to preserve it. And I have to tell you, that's just, it's great for the town. It's certainly going to preserve the integrity and the charm of the downtown on Front Street for at least the next 25 to 30 years. And I have to say, people should be thankful for what that company has done in trying to preserve the identity of the downtown and the importance of the Welsh Company. So again, I just thought it bared recognizing that. The other thing I wanted to report is that the Special Bylaw Review Committee met at the beginning of this month. They'll be meeting again Wednesday. I think it's the 30th, if I'm not mistaken. Sorry, Kim. It is. It'll be in this room. There will be a draft, just a preliminary draft on different ideas about what the Special Bylaw Committee is looking to try to revise. And would certainly recommend a lot of people to do just that. If they'd like to participate, come down, ask in advance for copies, and we'll provide it to them so they can take a look at it. But that's moving forward, just to let you know. And outside of that, that's it, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, John. Was there any representative from the old bylaw review? Have they met to send?
I don't think they have, Mr. Chair, because I don't think they've. I think with the appointment of Mr. Monger, I'm not sure if they've met their quotas, and I'm hoping that, in light of Mr. Monger participating as well as some of the other members that are presently on, that they could. Bless you.
Thank you.
That they could maybe get a liaison. Yeah.
You did it properly.
I was going to say we watched. It was on TV, whether you got in the elbow or not. You did. I bear witness to it.
I'm glad you sneezed to the left.
I noticed that. Next one is going that way, to the right. any event, no, there was not a liaison member, and I hope that that committee could convene, even if we could maybe, Kim, get a notice for the members to convene so that they can appoint a liaison to participate, because they'd be a great value.
If they don't, maybe we can appoint, you know what I mean? If they, we can appoint one of their, appoint one of their members to our appointment. I don't know, but just, I think we want to get that committee represented on your committee.
On the special bylaw review committee, sure.
Thank you. Tony?
Just to reiterate what John said about the Course Foundation, that the event is Friday, and if you don't want to play golf, you can still go to the dinner and participate in the auctions and stuff. It's really a great time, going to a great cause. Capital Planning met this evening and started the preliminary discussions about the capital plan, and I think our next meeting, I know our next meeting is October 13th, if that interests anybody in this room here. Another meeting that's coming up is the after-school activity meeting. That's coming up this week, so anyone that's interested in that will be addressing some of those issues. And lastly, well, first of all, I'm sure a bunch of you guys noticed as well, they started construction on the down at the field for the entranceway and the ticket booth. So nice to see us, you know, them getting started right away on that. And just to piggyback that, if you're looking for some good, inexpensive entertainment, the high school football teams and the high school sports are doing great in Scituate. The local football teams, in terms of just the other thing, you go down to that field anytime on the weekend, there's some sort of game going on, and it's really gets a good turnout, and it's good entertaining, and you see some of the families that you see around town out there. So if it's a sunny day or even a rainy day, as a couple weeks ago, head down to the field and support the local causes. It's really fun, and it's good to see the community out there to watch them. So that's all.
Thank
I
you.
Have.
Thank you. Next item.
Correspondence.
Anything there? I don't know if there is.
Special town.
Just the special town meeting to let everybody know there is a special preliminary primary election for the United States Senate. It's set for December 8th, 2009. It'll be held at the Scituate High School gym from 7 a.m. until 8 p.m. And it looks as though that the final date for voter registration for the primary election is Wednesday, November 18th. To register, please go to the town clerk's office. The clerk's office will be open until 8 p.m. for voter registration on that date. And as far as the special state election, obviously, the special state election for the United States Senate is set for January 19th, 2010. So, folks, the primaries are going to be on the December 8th, and then you're going to have the final vote for the actual election on January 19th, 2010. It, too, will be held at the high school, as all elections, from 7 a.m. until 8 p.m., and the final day for voter registration in that election would be Wednesday, December 30th, 2009. So, just to reiterate it, if you want to vote for the primary, make sure you get registered at the town clerk's office by Wednesday, November 18th. The election is going to be then held on December 8th. If after that, the final election, you need to register. You got to register as of Wednesday, December 30th, and then you get to vote on January 19th of 2010.
Thank you.
Well, the other was the seasonal flu pneumonia clinics, which we've been told
pretty
has been
that.
Canceled. That's taken care of. So, folks, that takes care of the correspondence this evening.
Next.
Move that the Board of Selectmen vote to accept the minutes of September 8,
2009. Second.
Discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? It's unanimous.
Move the Board of Selectmen vote to adjourn the meeting at 8:31.
Second.
Further discussion? Seeing none. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Thank you all.
Good night, folks.